this Friday evening, this holiday weekend, that's going to give everyone an extra day to relax. And for many in the political world, it's going to be a time to reflect, some will still campaign, on how the heck we got to the place we're at. We're going to start today with the Republican Party and Donald Trump, who now has been deemed to have won enough delegates to be named the presumptive Republican nominee more than ever. So, John, looking back at everything that happened from the descending escalator to now, let's review. How did Donald Trump go from longest of shots, even by his own estimation, to the nominee of the Republican Party?
Well, I think that one of the things that is overlooked is the extent to which Trump has, in a rather cagey and canny way, looked at what was happening in the Republican Party over the course of the last 20 years and figured out a way to capitalize it in a way that no one else had. I mean, the key components of his victory, the elements in the Republican base that have been ascendant, the elements that are populist, you could say nativist, certainly nationalist, isolationist, again, some would say xenophobic. You can apply different kinds of verbs or adjectives to it, but that part of the base has been growing for a long time, and no presidential candidate previously has been able to just say, I'm going straight at that, and then combining that with his candidate skills, his celebrity, his ability to dominate the media, that was key. But I think really getting what was going on in the party was at the core of it in a way that a lot of people don't appreciate or give him enough credit for.
And as we've said many times, the field was weak. It was much weaker than people thought, and Trump represented change, and he represented not being a politician. There were other people in the race, like Ted Cruz, a new senator, like Carly Fiorina, like Ben Carson, who were also kind of anti-Washington, anti-politicians. But no one entered the race with as clearly defined a brand that basically said, you guys don't like the direction the country's going in? I've been saying for 30 years I don't like the direction the country's going in. And Trump had a fingertip feel for every step of the process. Remarkable. First-time candidate in a Republican Party, which normally rewards the person whose turn it is, is rewarded with the nomination. But I've been asking a lot of Republicans in the last couple weeks as it became clear Trump was going to win. Turn the clock back. Same field. Tell every candidate besides Trump, here's what's going to happen. Could any of them have stopped him? And I haven't heard an answer yet that makes me think this was anything but Trump's to lose, and he won it.
Well, let me just add one more thing, which I think is important, which is that Trump realized at some point that there was a greater price to pay for being perceived as a prepackaged, pre-programmed, poll-tested politician than there was for being offensive. And that people were readier, in the Republican Party at least, to tolerate offensiveness than they were to tolerate another Max Headroom bobblehead Republican nominee, which is what a lot of them thought of Mitt Romney, for instance. You know, he was like, I'll take that risk that even if I piss them off, they'll like it because I'll seem real.
And if it is brand.
Yeah.
All right, so the second question is, what does Trump need to do now, between now and the convention? What's on the Trump to-do list to get ready for Cleveland?
Well, there's still some party unification to get done. There's money to raise, for sure. I mean, he's got to start raising some money and pulling together. He started to do this already this last week, getting some of these big bundlers and donors together. But he faces a big financial deficit with Clinton. He's got to raise some of that cash. He's got to get some organization in place. I know he says he doesn't place as much value on it as a normal nominee might be. He's got to do something in that place. And then he's got to figure out who's going to be his vice presidential pick, who his running mate's going to be, which is going to be a huge thing. That, the convention, and the debates are going to matter more than anything. But for Trump in particular, the VP pick really, really matters because he has no political background and no governing experience.
One other big thing he needs to do, which I think he started on in some earnest way, in earnest sense this week with his energy speech on Thursday in North Dakota. Trump needs an issues matrix. He needs, for the purposes of winning this election, to be more about insults and more about TV performance. So energy speech, Thursday press conference, he also talked about things like taxes, regulation. He talked about legal reform and judges and the distinction there, which he's talked about previously. Trump needs a center-right coalition on issues where the Republican Party can not just unite, but can win. So when Trump talks about cutting taxes, when he talks about getting rid of regulation, when he talks about energy and sort of a more of a free market approach to energy, those are all issues that Paul Ryan can agree with him on, and where you could potentially see a winning national coalition for a party that has lost the popular vote in five of the last six elections.
And it's not just, and I think you're right about the issues, it's not just about the issues, it's also about, by addressing the issues, it helps him to clear the bar of fitness for office, because right now, if he spends a lot of time just trashing people and flying off the handle and getting into Twitter battles and offending people, the more he spends time focused on substance, the less time he'll spend doing that. And that's, I think, good for him in terms of
clearing the bar. I've been talking to folks who've been talking to Trump about substance and their areas of substance, and they've been impressed that he's clearly learning. He's asking questions, but he also doesn't know everything. I mean, he is less steeped in policy than, I think, in some ways, than anyone who's ever been nominated in the modern era, because he's not been involved in public policy. And the Clinton people look at that and say it's a joke. The fact that he's willing to admit he doesn't know everything about everything, which he did again this week on energy, a lot of voters are going to find refreshing. I don't think that's going to cause him to lose if he continues to get to Election Day and doesn't know everything and admits it. But I do think, as you suggested, showing that he cares about policy, that he knows about policy, is a way to punch the ticket that he needs to punch, which is this guy an acceptable president? All right, we're going to be right back. We're going to talk about Hillary Clinton and what she needs to do to close this deal with her party, and then pivot to the general election, that topic, and more right after this.
Hillary Clinton is not yet the presumptive nominee of the Democratic Party, as she's still got to play in California, New Jersey, and a bunch of other states. And there is still Bernie Sanders out there fighting hard and promising to fight on all the way until Philadelphia, where the Democratic convention will take place at the end of July. Mark, many people assume that the Republican race would go on and there'd be a contested convention, and Democrats would all just have this all tied up in a neat little bow. Quite the opposite has occurred. What does Secretary Clinton need to do over the course of these coming weeks before Philadelphia to advance her cause to become the next president of the United States?
Her senior strategists are resigned to Sanders going all the way to the convention. There was some hope they had that Sanders maybe could be eased out of the race after California. They now think that's not likely to happen. They're not even necessarily going to try. That's unfortunate for them because it's going to be hard to unify, and it makes going into the convention volatile. They've developed a very jaundiced view of Sanders and his personality. And now they face the task of trying to unify the party between the end of the nomination fight, the primaries and caucuses, and the convention, with Sanders still out there. What Bernie Sanders plans to do with his time after the primaries and caucuses end, I think, is a big question that the Clinton folks are also wondering about. She needs to get the fundamentals right. There's going to be a ton of press attention on Sanders, and that's an important thing. But like Trump, she needs to pick a running mate that is both exciting and qualified. She needs to plan a really good convention to help try to reintroduce herself once again to the American people. And then she needs to kick some butt in the debates, particularly the first one.
I think in the more immediate future here, I think really winning California and New Jersey would be really helpful. In terms of delegates, it's not going to matter. She's going to eventually be the Democratic nominee on the basis of delegates. Pledged delegates, she'll have the lead. Popular vote, she'll have the lead. With combination with superdelegates, she'll be the nominee. But winning those would be symbolically important.
She's going to win New Jersey, but California she could lose, and it would be bad for her.
Why I'm saying I think it would really help her in terms of her argument with Sanders and in terms of unifying the party if she could win those two big
states.
Unfortunately
for her, I hate to sound negative about this, but this is asymmetrical. It's fine for her if she wins. It's bad for her if she loses.
I know, but that's why I say would really help her if she won. And then I think, you know, the bottom line really is that Bernie Sanders, as was the case in 2008, this is one of these weird situations where the vanquished has more power to unite the party than the victor does. So a lot of this does come back to Sanders, but I think she will have to approach those negotiations and those conversations with grace and dignity, try to be as forthcoming with Sanders and respectful of his incredible accomplishment, which is an incredible thing, what he has done, starting where he started, getting to where he's gotten to, and especially be as solicitous as possible to his voters, paying heed to his issues. She has to do all those things to handle them very well. She still can't guarantee the right outcome here. Most of it still rests with Sanders, but there are things she can do to make it more likely that unity is achieved.
I'll just say one more thing. This is where Hillary Clinton could learn from Donald Trump, but she's not his equal. It's just a pure performer. When Trump vanquished opponents, he then spoke very nicely about them most of the time. When she needs to turn and start praising Bernie Sanders, you know, she's going to have to show more political skill than she normally does. All right, moving on.
Oh, my God, that was James Carville. Just popped right up and basically instead of the buzzer, right?
Yeah, what's going on?
I love when he does that. All right, second question for our show today in this block, Mark. Clinton, Assuming she does, as I said, is almost certain she becomes the nominee after Philadelphia. We just talked about the period from now to Philadelphia. After Philadelphia, what does she do to deal with Trump?
As I said, she needs to reintroduce herself at the convention. She needs to get ready for the debates. I think it comes down to one thing. I understand all the negative attacks on Trump, and they're going to try to take him out. I really do believe if she convinces people that she'll be better for their pocketbooks as president than Trump, she'll win. She's never had a clearly defined economic message in any of her campaigns. Yeah. She needs that. She needs to basically convince corporate America, Main Street America, independent voters, young people, wow, this would be exciting. Hillary Clinton as president is going to make the economy great.
I talked with three key architects of Bill Clinton's economic agenda over the course of this week after we did a segment earlier this week talking about how the Clinton campaign didn't have innovative new ideas or an overarching theme. All three of them agreed with me. Two of them are fans of hers. One of them is a fan of Sanders. All three said, totally right, that she has not put together either the policies nor the connective tissue nor the rhetorical gloss on an agenda for the future of the American economy where people are frustrated, anxiety-ridden, stagnant wages, income inequality, all of that. She doesn't have it yet. If she can get it, I think she can put Trump away on that basis, given the structural advantages she has, the demographic advantages. But right now, that is a huge missing piece. And if she can do it, it will offset a lot. It'll help distract people from some of her weaknesses, both as a performer and on the trustworthiness issues.
And this
she's got to have that message.
This goes back to her self-admitted weakness as a candidate. Can she simultaneously do something she's never done that's really hard, have a theory of the case on the economy, and continue to be used as an attack dog on a daily basis against Donald Trump? That's a hard thing to do. She is suffering by comparison, not just to Trump as a performer, but the last three presidents, all of whom could, with a light touch, push their positive message and the negative message.
Do you think that she needs an attack dog as a vice president to take some of that burden off her?
Not a classic, like, attack dog, but somebody who can drive that message, absolutely. Right. But also someone who can get attention. And if she goes for someone who's solid, but the media doesn't really want to cover, we've seen nominees who are lonely out there, Maytag repairmen, not getting covered.
I'm not going to ask you for predictions because I don't do that, but I'm going to ask you, just name a couple people in the Democratic Party who kind of fit that bill.
Too soon to say.
All right.
Too soon.
I'll try. I try with you, and I just never get there. All right. We'll be right back, right here, with Al Hunt of Bloomberg View, who we love, and Margaret Taleb of Bloomberg Politics, who we love just as much, right after this.
Joining us now, Al Hunt of Bloomberg View and Margaret Taleb, our colleague from Bloomberg Politics. Thank you both for joining us. Al, you wrote this week about the efforts within the Democratic Party to bring these two very strong-willed people together. Tell us your thoughts on where it stands and where you think it's headed.
Well, none of us thought it would go longer than the Republicans, did we, Mark? Very few of us did. And there's obviously been some tension. There are some differences. They both resent some things the other side has done. But this is not 1968. It's not even Carter and Kennedy in 1980. And I think there already are efforts to talk about what they do post June 7th. There are compromises that I think are fairly obvious. One problem has been the Democratic chair, Debbie Wasserman Schultz. You know, it may be that no man's an island, but she's Greenland. I mean, she really is unpopular with everybody. But other people have jumped in. Donna Brazile, the vice chair of the party, talking to both sides. So I think they can work out something on the platform, a caveat in just a second. Anything he wants on rules in 2020, she'll give to him because 2020 never is going to happen. And the caveat I have on the platform is that he's put a bunch of real lefties on there, like Cornel West. And if they start driving issues like the Israeli-Palestine issue, that'll really split the party, and it's up to Bernie to rein them in.
Margaret, I was struck by, as the week ended, the reaction in the Clinton camp to the Cornel West appointment, and just a general negative feeling among some of the Clinton high command towards Bernie Sanders personally and his refusal to bend towards where they think he needs to go.
There really is sort of, Clinton talks about the head and the heart sometimes, and in their heads they all still figure Bernie Sanders will come around, but in their hearts they're not 100% sure, and they're really frustrated about it. And I think one really interesting dynamic to watch is that of sort of Senator Elizabeth Sanders versus how
Elizabeth Warren.
Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders. Yeah, that's her name.
We'll get those names straight.
But Elizabeth Warren, you know, there were so many questions about would she help Clinton or hurt Clinton, and would she come out in favor of Sanders, and was she going to sign up with Joe Biden and all this sort of stuff last summer. But now she's very strongly in this sort of supportive and championing role of whoever the Democratic nominee is, and that being clear that if it's Clinton, she'll be there for her. Whereas Sanders is really in a different position, and he has Ted Cruz's example to look at as how he does not want to return to the U.S. Senate. So those are factors that I think the Clinton camp is looking at as likely to bring him along.
Hey, Mark,
I just say one thing, though.
Sure.
Hillary Clinton has not said that Bernie Sanders' father assassinated John F. Kennedy. So I think there's a little bit less personal tension. Bernie, as mad as he is, and I think Margaret's absolutely right about that, he has told people, I'm not Ralph Nader. I don't want to be Ralph Nader. And what they care about is what they call the Bernie brand. And for the Bernie brand to continue and flourish after this election, he's got to get some real concessions on things like the platform. And secondly, he's got to be credited with helping energize Democrats in the fall.
Al, let me just stick with this for one more second longer. I mean, I have been among those who, for all along, who has said, you know, y'all are forgetting how bitter 2008 was. The 2008 paradigm should apply here. You know, if Bernie Sanders gets to the end, fights to the end, there's some accommodations reached of the kind you're talking about on the platform and otherwise, and he endorses Clinton wholeheartedly and helps nominate her at the convention, that they'll all come together just like they did back in 2008. The one hitch to me, it seems, is not just on this platform thing. The thing that causes me to sometimes revise my view about that is just the extent to which Sanders has, how far he's gone in terms of painting her as corrupt and part of the oligarchy and the system that he's trying to revolutionize. And my question about that is, even if he does those things, does all the right things, will that actually convince the voters that he's been arguing, telling all year long, for a year and a half now, that she's basically almost as bad as Trump? Will that actually convince them to come over into her column with energy and conviction?
Well, I don't know about the energy part, John, but I think he'll be able to draw a real distinction about it. He hates Trump, and he
yes.
hates Trump as a genuinely evil man. I think he'll make that case. Jeff Markey, the only senator who's endorsed Bernie, says that he thinks if Bernie comes on board, and he's not predicting he's going to be defeated yet, that he thinks that most of the followers will follow. Not all, but most. And I think that's up to him. Look, he's going to say the system is rigged. I don't think the system really was rigged, but he'll get rules changes for 2020, which none of us will pay any attention to, and he'll say, well, at least we've partially unrigged the system. I think it's not hard to walk this back. It may be that emotions and personalities will prevent that, John, and we can't be sure, but I just think all signs point to Bernie Sanders not wanting to be Ralph Nader in 2016.
Right. Margaret, you remember 2008 pretty well, I know. And there was, again, a lot of invective between Obama and Clinton. But neither Obama nor Clinton ever suggested that the other person was, again, kind of suggested that they were corrupt. They would say a lot of mean things about each other, but they never went quite that far. And a lot of the people who loved Hillary Clinton were kind of upset about the notion that their chance to have the first woman president had been supplanted by the first African-American nominee and then president. But they weren't, they didn't sort of somehow suspect somehow that Barack Obama was part of a corrupt overclass, right? And so those Puma voters eventually came around. I just, again, I said to Al, I have some doubt about whether a lot of these millennials are going to look up and, just because Bernie says so, throw their arms around Hillary Clinton.
Right. I mean, the closest comparison probably in 2008 wasn't on the issue of corruption, right? It was on the issue of readiness. Who's going to answer the phone at 3 o'clock in the morning, and could a President Obama handle the situation in Afghanistan, et cetera? And the Obama campaign was concerned at the time that even though he was locking down the nomination, it might be difficult for people to see him as sort of ready to be commander-in-chief because of some of the questions she herself had raised. Certainly by becoming a Secretary of State, she addressed that later on, but even during the general election, having the Clintons kind of rally around him and saying, well, he is ready now, did make a big difference. But also, don't forget that she and Bill Clinton represented the core of the establishment, which was something that Barack Obama wanted and needed at the time for legitimacy. And you know, Hillary Clinton, if she's the nominee, will need Bernie Sanders to bring his voters along for a while, but he doesn't represent the same kind of core security that spans across both parties that the Clintons did for Obama in 2008.
And John, as convinced as I am that Bernie will come along, I too am not sure that some of those young voters in particular are going to come around. I think Hillary Clinton's going to do very well with Latino voters. I think she'll do almost as well with African-American voters as Barack Obama did last time. But I think young voters are a big challenge for her, and I don't think Bernie just saying, you know, come by eye is going to do it. It's just going to have to be more than that.
Al, just to switch quickly to our poll we did, you spearheaded with our colleagues at Purple Strategies, the Bloomberg Purple Slice poll, on looking at the battleground states in the Midwest, particularly focusing in on the slice of the electorate that's working class voters, kind of middle income. The headline there is that Clinton is ahead with those voters, and the assumption is Trump's going to need to win that group or do better than he's doing in this poll. But talk about some of the stuff elsewhere in the poll that you found interesting in terms of how the voters perceive on a more personal basis those two candidates.
Yeah, Mark, it's such a good way. He does have to win in those four states, those Rust Belt states. He could carry Florida and Virginia and Colorado and New Hampshire and Iowa. And if he doesn't carry one of those four states, he still loses. Two questions that normally are not asked that really interested us was, which of these two candidates, Clinton or Trump, do you think would be a better role model for your children? Now, she's not very popular. She doesn't do great, but she just laps him. I mean, they just think he would be a terrible role model. And secondly, the question of who would you want to have as a guest in your home? And again, she does much better than Trump, who does very badly, particularly with women voters. And you know, since 1980, people have voted for the presidential candidate who comes across as more personally appealing. Neither one really meets that standard this time, except and right now he is viewed as a no-nonsense, tough guy, but also a cruel, not very nice man. And that problem is bigger than the considerable problems that she has.
And those states, again, that we polled were Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, yes. Michigan, and Ohio, right? Margaret, yep. On our poll and the other polling out this week, the Clinton folks have tried to point to all the silver linings. But do you get the sense that they're concerned about the current state of the race, or do they think they're on the glide path they need to be on?
Of course, they're concerned about it on a couple of fronts. Number one is, even though there are a lot of problems with general election polling that occurs this early, and particularly when it's national polling, anything that shows Donald Trump closing in and, you know, within 10 points is cause for some alarm on their part. And second of all, this FBI investigation into the emails is still hanging out over her head. And the latest sort of development this week on that parallel front with the inspector general was really not cause for celebration. The Clinton campaign has put the best spin they could on it, but nonetheless takes issue and highlights wrongdoing on her part. So these are real problems for her, and to the extent that Donald Trump is able to capitalize on the trust issue, this trust problem that is pervasive in state after state, including those Midwest states, it is something that she needs to try to get past now.
All right, Margaret Taleff, thank you. Al Hunt, great Tom and great Purple Slice poll. The two-front war for Hillary Clinton continues. Thank you both. And we'll be right back.
Joining us now is the former senior strategist to the Chris Christie for President campaign, Mike DuHaime. Actually, I like to think of you more as a mastermind.
Thank you very much. That sounds very good.
Tell me, as of now, given everything that's transpired over the past couple of weeks, good and bad, where stands in your mind the Trump Republican Unity Project?
Well, I think the Unity Project is still a work in progress. Obviously, with where Mitt Romney is, where Paul Ryan is, with Susana Martinez earlier this week, I think the Unity Project is still a work in progress. I like to think it's getting better, but it's got to get better. But I also think it disguises, you know, what is really a bigger opportunity. I actually think he's in a better position than most people think because there are so many distractions like that. But I actually think the fundamental kind of big questions in the campaign have actually shaped up better for him than I thought they were going to in terms of the contrast with Hillary.
Let me just ask you to play psychoanalyst for 1 second, because I know as a campaign strategist, you've looked at people who are running against Chris Christie, and one of them was Donald Trump.
Sure.
He was making enormous progress in this process of bringing the party together, moving much faster than a lot of people thought possible. And then he decides to go out and beat Susana Martinez up and has now aroused the ire of a bunch of people who ran against him and other Republican establishmentarians. What's going on in that man's head? Because this was like gratuitous, right? There was no particular reason to attack Susana Martinez.
I don't know the answer to that. I wish I knew. I do think there was a method to the madness for much of the primary. I will say this week I'm not so sure what it was, other than this is who he is. And quite frankly, picking on the establishment is something that he's been good at and has treated him well so thus far. And I don't think he's going to change. And I think there's an element of he's the guy who's not just kind of anti-Washington, he's anti-politician. And he's shown that he'll pick on both parties if he thinks it achieves his ends. Whether or not it's going to achieve that end, I don't know. But it does reinforce in the people who like him what they like about him. The people who like him aren't really worried about Susana Martinez. It's the people who maybe are still on the fence or the people who are very against Trump that find that so offensive.
Just tell us, just so we're clear, where you are on your nominee, or your presumptive nominee. Are you supporting Donald
Trump? Yeah, I'll support Donald Trump. I mean, I obviously supported Chris Christie in the primary, but the voters have a say, and there's a process, and they had their say, and he's the nominee.
And are you someone who's advising him directly or indirectly?
No, I'm not. I have no involvement in the campaign in any official way. Obviously, continue to informally help my friend Chris Christie and his Governor Christie in his efforts, but I have no official role.
So if the phone rings over the weekend and it's Donald Trump and he says, Mike, what can I do better? What would you tell him?
I would like to see the Unity Project move a little bit longer. I think there are things that I think focusing on Hillary Clinton really is the way to go. As I said, I think the big fundamental pieces of this are actually in a pretty good place for him. He is very much a non-politician agent of change in a time where people want change, and she is very much the status quo. And none of these other sidebar issues are going to change that very much. And also, I think as people worry about the economy, he's a business guy, and that's been a very strong thing from the beginning, something that was probably underestimated by other Republican campaigns early on, that he is really seen by the average voter as somebody who's a fiscal expert. People can debate whether that's true or not, but he has certainly seen that way.
Another big theme of this week in terms of the presumptive Republican nominee has been nostalgia of a certain kind of dark kind back to the 1990s. Donald Trump has attacked Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton, kind of indistinguishably brought up. Monica Lewinsky, Kathleen Willey, Juanita Broderick, brought up the conspiracy theories around Vince Foster's death. There was reporting about the fact they were seeking out help from the RNC to go relitigate Whitewater. Mm-hmm. Just as a political strategist, someone who was in line to be the senior strategist for someone else who would have been running in a general election against Hillary Clinton, does that seem like a fruitful line of attack to you? Is that something you would have wanted Chris Christie to pursue if you were the nominee?
Not so much the relitigating in the past. I think all elections ultimately are about the future. It's interesting. Hillary Clinton is so fixed in terms of what people think about her. It's not bad to bring these things up in the past to remind people, you know, essentially why they don't like her. But I think as we get down, you know, further into the campaign, it is going to be about, you know, what can people do for me in the next 2 or 4 years. So I think in some of those may or may not have leaked out and how far they would have gone with them, I don't know. But I think what he's showing, what Donald Trump is showing, is the same thing he showed in the first debates when he took on Jeb Bush and wasn't afraid to do anything, is nothing is off limits for him. And I think that's something that certainly it sets the Clinton campaign out of balance. I've seen some reports that they really don't know where he's going. And that's a very good thing. It's a very unpredictable campaign. Had it been someone like Ted Cruz, this would have been a very traditional red-blue map. We would have had to, you know, thread the needle and win Florida and Ohio and one or two other states. I think it's very unpredictable. I think for them going to the debates, all this does, it throws her campaign off. So in that sense, it's good for Trump.
It is pretty clear that the Clinton folks and their allies are going to go after Trump the way the Obama folks went after Mitt Romney, a businessman who got rich on the backs of less fortunate people, workers who mm-hmm. didn't do as well. That worked on Mitt Romney pretty well, it would appear. Mm-hmm. Will that work on Donald Trump?
I think it will be less successful, and partly it's because Trump embraces it. I think Mitt Romney was never fully comfortable with it and was kind of didn't talk about it in a comfortable way. Trump embraces it, and I saw it when I was in the field working for Governor Christie. I saw people just would say, you know, it didn't matter what the issues were. They would say, boy, that guy, you know, he's got his own plane. Yeah, he's got his own plane. He's a successful business guy. He's a rich guy. He's doing great. People saw it as something that they aspired to, or at least saw it as a success. And I, for whatever reason, Mitt was never as comfortable with that. And I think Donald Trump will embrace it in a way that makes it better for him.
So when the Democrats, as we suspect they will, trot out ads and videos with people who say, you know, I went to Trump University, or I worked in this factory, or whatever it is, I got the shaft, Donald Trump got rich. How does he effectively respond?
I think it's going to be hard for Hillary Clinton to paint herself as, you know, this champion of the middle class with the paid speeches and everything they've done and millions of dollars that will be thrown around. I think it'll be a wash. I'm not saying that that's going to be something that takes Hillary Clinton down by any stretch.
What is Trump's rhetoric in response to an ad?
Donald Trump. One of the things Donald Trump is proven so far is he can communicate in a way with middle class voters that not a lot of other Republicans or Democrats really do a good job. This is a guy who's lived his life in the media market, giving quotes to the New York Post. This is a guy who spent a lot of time on construction sites, a lot of time, you know, around, you know, blue-collar workers. He knows how to communicate in a way that she doesn't, and quite frankly, a lot of us didn't give him credit for early on.
A lot of the Democrat hope here comes down to the Democratic sense that Hillary Clinton is still the favorite in this race, comes down to demographics and to Donald Trump's unfavorables with certain really important groups, like Hispanics, like female voters, right? So, A, do you think those, you know, being at 70% disapproval with those two groups, how big a problem, and speak to each one, how big a problem do you think it is? And to the extent that you think it's a problem, how would you try to fix it if you were counseling Trump?
I think they're both serious problems. There's no doubt about it. Demographically, Democrats, any Democrat would have an advantage over any Republican going to this. We've lost a popular vote in five out of the last six elections, right? And going back to the 1980s, this map is fundamentally in Democrat place. So he's got to do a better job of that. And quite frankly, if it was anybody other than Hillary Clinton, I would say this is a major problem. But I've seen some polling recently in some congressional districts where they are both wildly unpopular, and he is winning. And I think what it comes down to is elections are not a referendum on Donald Trump.
Right.
It is a choice between two people, and for him, I would continue to make that contrast with Hillary Clinton.
But is the Hispanic thing fixable? And if he came to you and said, Mike, can I fix this or not? And if you think I can fix it, what would you tell me to do?
I don't know that it's fixable, but it can get better. And I think, you know, I think oftentimes as Republicans, we kind of dwell on that. We aspire to be where President Bush was, where he got 44% of the vote during his reelection campaign. You obviously have some governors like Governor Christie, Governor Kasich, who've won it in their elections. That's not going to happen here. But quite frankly, John McCain was very good on immigration and issues like that, and he got crushed in the Hispanic community. Mitt Romney, you know, because I think mostly because of Obamacare, got crushed, you know, with Hispanics in Nevada and places like that. So how much worse is Trump going to do? I'm not really sure how much worse he's going to do, but I think so obviously there could be some rhetorical changes and focusing on the economy that I think would make it better.
So who's the favorite, Trump or Clinton?
I think Clinton is the favorite because, as you said, the demographic is just the way the states lined up. When places like New York and California and Illinois are not even really competitive at this point, obviously there's an electoral map advantage. But I think he has a better chance than I certainly thought he did around New Hampshire, South Carolina, that time of the campaign. I think it's certainly getting better for him.
One name, who's the smartest vice presidential pick you could make?
Oh, I think, well, I'd like Governor Christie, obviously, is a good idea. I think Senator Corker is a good thought as well. I think he'll go for somebody, either high-level governor or Senate experience.
All right, our thanks. Mike DuHaime, thanks for stopping by. Always great to see you. Up next, former Bill Clinton advancement Josh King, the author of Off Script, an advanced man's guide to White House stagecraft, campaign spectacle, and political suicide. And don't forget, if you're watching us in Washington, D.C., you can listen to us as well on the radio at Bloomberg 99.1 FM. We'll be right back.
We are joined now by Bill Clinton's King of Advance, Josh King, who was head of advance in Bill Clinton's White House, and is the author of the new book, Off Script.
Call it that?
Yes.
Huh. It's got a very complicated subtitle.
Off Script,
that we
an advanced man's guide to White House stagecraft, campaign spectacle,
political suicide.
Yeah. Josh is back, so we can look again at the optics of both Trump and Clinton events. We're going to start first with Trump event. Got a lot of attention, a big event out in Anaheim, California. Orange County. Tell us about it.
That's right, Mark. Earlier this week, you know, Trump was back east in Kentucky and at the Chris Christie fundraiser. It's so great to have him back in his standard rally setup, first in Albuquerque and now at the Orange County Convention Center in Anaheim. You see your standard classic Trump setup, a nice curated crowd. If you thought that the Trump constituency was highly male, if you take a close look at this, you see as many female faces in the crowd as there are male faces. And don't think this is by accident. You look at pictures of an event site like this before the crowd even gets there, the signs are perfectly positioned in a checkerboard fashion. They know exactly who's going to be in the backdrop, and they want this picture brought home. Good Trump signage in the foreground and the background, excellent lighting. Fore lighting and back lighting creates this halo effect around the Trump hair, and you always have to have halo effect around the Trump hair, Mark. So if you're Trump and you come to the Orange County Convention Center, you're really pleased with what happened out inside the Orange County Convention Center.
I'll just note once again, you got the Anaheim thing there. You say always important to say where he is.
Always important
for the locals.
And because if you are the layout editor of the Orange County Register, which we'll see in a second, you want to see this for your local pride. But there was a lot of activity outside while this rally was happening. Not all good.
Let me just ask you this question real quickly. The guy with the bow tie right there, is that important semiotically?
It is, actually. I looked at him earlier, and I thought back to my days working for Illinois Senator Paul Simon. Yeah. I thought that is a pay-in to the Southern Illinois.
The bow tie.
American
flag bow tie. This is the man with the bow tie.
Yeah. Okay. Right. All right, so that was inside, pretty spectacularly staged as usual. Outside, a different story.
Outside, the residents of Orange County took a cue from what you saw in Albuquerque the previous day. Protests, several arrests, I think there were six. And it's a magnet not only for the protesters. These are Trump people arguing with the cops. And you have the lenses here. So there's activity that needs to be covered as a local story. And we all remember, you know, what is politics, as according to Tip O'Neill? It's local. So as much as we might think that everyone's watching with all due respect on Bloomberg tonight, what people are really interested in California tomorrow is what's going to be on the sidewalks when the Orange County Register arrives.
You'd be surprised how many Orange County viewers we have, Josh, but okay.
So here it is. And if you think about what the eye does when the newspaper front page arrives, Battleground Orange County, that's the big story. What typifies Battleground Orange County? It's the protest outside between the Trump protesters and others. Your eye moves down to the left, slightly above this picture here, feisty messaging crowd. Trump gets his notice, but not nearly as big as he might have had this protest not been outside the convention center. Move down a little bit on your angle, and you have Hillary Clinton. Clinton tells OC, Trump is a divider, not a uniter. So a lot of them got, this was the whole story, according to the layout editors of the Orange County Register that day.
So you're mentioning Hillary Clinton here. She's been in California a lot too, and in Orange County. She was in Riverside for an event that you want to talk about in a little more detail.
Yeah, let's look at
Let's take a look at that.
She is at University of California, Riverside. And you know, she can't attract the 8,000 people at an event that Donald Trump can right now. But if you are the Clinton campaign orchestrating the press that is coming with you, you're setting up a small pool of photographers that are given really intimate access as she enters the Johnson Family Practice Center. So if I'm a photographer, I'm being escorted by a campaign aide, and I'm right down here shooting her. And I can't tell that there are only several hundred people in this arena as opposed to several thousand. I'm looking under, I'm getting this up angle. And again, look at this curated crowd. This is the Obama coalition assembled for her in California.
It's a beautiful mosaic. Let me ask you a question about the crowd size. If Hillary Clinton came to you, if you were working for a campaign, she said, I need a 10,000 person rally, build that crowd. Could they build it if they spent money? Or they literally couldn't match Trump's crowd size?
Well, I think they probably could. First of all, you could do a few things. She's got not as many Twitter followers and Facebook followers as Trump does, but she does have, in California especially, a huge following in the creative community. So if you were to get Bruce Springsteen, Ellen DeGeneres,
well,
other
sure,
people
but with
come
that,
out.
But short of that, Trump's not bringing gimmicks.
That's
stunts.
Right.
She
That's
couldn't
right.
build a crowd that size, so she needs to do this to make it look like she's got big crowds.
Again, we've known her in this capacity since 1992. Trump is the celebrity that comes to these locations.
I want to understand this thing right here.
Yeah, right. So, John, if you're an advanced person, you don't leave anything to chance at an event site. So you are at the Johnson Family Practice Center coming into the scene. Look at the scoreboard. Is that between UC Riverside and one of their opponents? No, it's Hillary Clinton. What do these numbers signify? Well, President Obama is president number 44. They're hoping, of course, she'll be president number 45.
They've been doing that all campaign.
I have to tell you, though, this looks to me like Hillary is running against herself and that the score is tied in a divided human.
That may be another way to interpret
that. The semiotics are very confusing to me, at least. Yeah. Okay.
Now, so she had a terrific event at UC Riverside, but the problem that she's been dogged with for the last several months is she can't have the stage all to herself. So if you go to the Inland Island Sun newspaper the next day, she gets her billing. Clinton, Democratic frontrunner, continues her attack during a speech in Riverside, but there's another candidate in the race who gets top of the fold. War of words in IE, Inland Empire, but the person who gets the more photographic real estate is Bernie Sanders.
Pure eye candy, that's the basis for it, right?
That's exactly right.
So if you're an advanced person and you're working for Hillary Clinton, you look at that and you say, what could we have done? Is it possible they could have gotten the bigger picture? Well-staged event, what could they have done to...
Well, the things that I would do, and you know, it's hard to do it with her, is give her props, make that picture more compelling, something that the photo editor says, we can't ignore this moment. Right. All she was a candidate with a handheld mic and a stool
rally,
just doing her own thing. She has to do more to make it interesting.
All right, Josh King, thanks for coming back, explaining the big images of the week. Josh King, again, did advance for Bill Clinton, is the author of the new book, Off Script, An Advanced Man's Guide to White House Stagecraft, Campaign Spectacle, and Political Suicide. We'll be right back with the great Will Leach and go to the movies with him right after this.
So if you're a politics junkie, normally the summertime is sort of a snooze, both in the political realm and in the realm of pop culture. Not so this summer. Obviously a lot going on in terms of politics, but also this summer at the cinema, there's going to be a ton of really fantastic, juicy, politically themed movies. So what do? To figure it out, to get a preview, we asked the great Will Leach, our Bloomberg Politics culture and cultural politics intersection correspondent, to take a look and take us to the movies.
It's almost summer, the air-conditioned movie season of superheroes, robots, sequels, comic book adaptations, and more superheroes and robots is upon us.
Yes, this is not the time for your high-minded Oscar fare, unless, of course, you include the Ninja Turtle sequel, produced by Michael Bay and starring Carmelo Anthony and Megan Fox. Nevertheless, on the eve of election, there are still some films that reflect and may impact the political race.
First off, Money Monster. Directed by Jodie Foster, a Jim Cramer-like Wall Street TV huckster, played by George Clooney, along with his producer, played by Julia Roberts, is taken hostage by an angry man who lost his life savings in an Enron Madoff-type scheme.
Take it out. Put it on.
How do I know it won't blow up?
Because I have the detonator.
If it's a hit, it's a film that jives with Bernie Sanders' anti-Wall Street message and will resonate with his supporters, whether the candidate himself is still in the race or not. Next, there is Wiener. Remember former Congressman Anthony Weiner's ill-fated, ill-conceived, darkly hilarious failed attempt to run for mayor of New York City? Well, there were documentarians there the whole time, capturing every minute, every interaction between Weiner and his wife, longtime Hillary Clinton confidant Huma Abedin. This is not exactly an incident, politician's spouse with woman problems. The Hillary camp is particularly eager to have back in everyone's minds.
This is the worst. Doing a documentary on my scandal.
Also coming soon, the Purge election year. I'm just gonna go ahead and quote the ad copy here. Trapped on the streets of Washington, D.C., a senator and her head of security must survive an annual night of terror where all crime is legal for 12 hours. It's the Purge, Washington style.
Join me as we eliminate evil.
This actually sounds like a movie Donald Trump would personally write in 140 character bursts. Sad. Speaking of the Donald, even the Ghostbusters reboot with Kristen Wiig and Melissa McCarthy has turned somehow political.
Now they're making Ghostbusters with only women. What's going on?
And finally, South Side with You, which is the most overtly political movie of the year. It stars Tika Sumpter and Parker Sawyers as Michelle and Barack Obama on their first date in Chicago before seeing Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing in 1989. It's a political before sunrise. While all the rest of us are losing our minds following this 2016 race, one almost envies the first couple's ability to get away from it all by sitting down to watch a movie about themselves.
I wonder if I can write books or hold a position of influence in civil rights.
Politics?
Maybe.
You haven't seen Wiener yet, right?
I've not.
You got to see Wiener.
Yeah.
It's incredible. I mean, truly incredible.
Wiener as Wiener.
All these movies, you know, I'm looking forward to the Ghostbusters, unlike Donald Trump. I think that's going to be great. Looking forward to that a lot. But the Wiener film I have seen, I will say, it is the documentary to end all documentaries in terms of being able to, in every documentary, there's a political documentary. There come moments where you think, God, I wish I was behind that closed door. I wish I was witnessing that moment right when the scandal hits, right at the most moments of most embarrassment. The camera's there at every one of those moments in Wiener. It's incredible.
Well, it's an advantage you have if you're a staffer than a filmmaker.
I know, but still, I'm saying from a viewer's point of view, you get to see really what it was like inside that campaign in a way that doesn't feel cheated like a lot of political documentaries you and I know.
I will court trouble by saying that I think Ghostbusters, while an incredible film, is slightly overrated.
The original?
The original is slightly overrated.
Oh, and, that's
and I'm
it.
Worried, and I'm
this
worried,
is over. You and me, we're done.
It's a great film, but it's slightly overrated. Okay. This one, so far, everything I've seen about it makes me a little worried. No, it makes me a little worried.
Okay. Well, I'm looking forward to that. I still don't think it's good politics for Trump to be trashing it, though, on Instagram. No, seems like a mistake to me. All right. Our thanks to the great and glorious Will Leach. We'll be right back.
Wunderbar. All right. That's our show. Thanks for watching. We'll be back on Tuesday. Monday's a holiday, of course. Brand new program. Same bad time, same bad channel. Until then, you can check out BloombergPolitics.com for all the latest news.
Coming up on Bloomberg West, Emily Chang talks to the CEO of NetApp. Have a great weekend, everybody. And it's going to be a long one. And from me and Mark, we say to you, sign off.